The Institute Presents on BCTV is supported by the Yocum Family Perpetual Charitable Trust.
Welcome to the Institute Presents. I'm Susan Rohn, the Executive Director, and my special guest today is Mike Miller, our featured artist at the Holleran Gallery at the Yocum Institute. Now, Mike's show opened on Friday night, and it's fascinating. You really need to see it. But let's get started, Mike, with you as far as your background. This is a very interesting show. It's very eclectic. How did you come to be putting this kind of a show together?
Well, it really originates from my history as an antique dealer or picker. Mm-hmm. 20 years ago I started, and I developed a style that was based on things that I liked. Mm-hmm. So I was buying all kinds of folk art and old snapshot photography and old people's old photo albums and things like that, mm-hmm. and weird paintings and old signs and things that I could recontextualize together, mm-hmm. and sell. And I had an audience for it, and it worked for me. So that's a good chunk of what this show is, those types of things. But the art that I made came out of doing that business and having all these materials that I was finding that I could use to make art. Predominantly it was photographs.
Yeah, there's quite a few that you have put together in a different way. But how did you, when we were talking earlier at the show, you mentioned your father was involved in this business?
My father is an auctioneer.
He had
a nice auctioneering business, which I actually am running right now to this day. He retired a few years ago, but he built this auction business. And as a kid, you know, in the mid 80s, I think it was when he started, and I'd have to be there helping. And mm-hmm. It was not my favorite thing to do at all. And didn't understand the appeal of a lot of what was happening there with the things that people bought, but I would always find time to be off to the side and look in some boxes, and I would see, you know, like turn of the century kinds of medical textbooks, mm-hmm. and there's all kinds of really lurid and disturbing and wonderful imagery and those kinds of things, and I would like them, but it never occurred to me to buy them, you know, because
But people did, but
they were more interested in boring furniture and things like that at the time, so it didn't make sense to me. But I grew up around that business, mm-hmm. so I saw a lot of the flow of items in the secondary market and all the kinds of crazy things that, you know, are out there that people make.
People. Right.
Yeah, yeah.
It is, it's interesting. But so what led you, you weren't originally in this business. So your father was in it, mm-hmm. you're running it now. Mm-hmm. But when did you decide that, yes, I like doing this, or I can do this?
Well, specifically the antique dealing end of the business was something that I found later. I went to school in Philadelphia to Temple University, and mm-hmm. I studied filmmaking there, and I was always very much an art-oriented person. I really liked art in many forms, and I was really into movies. I really enjoyed movies and the psychology of movies. Mm-hmm. So I studied that at Temple University, and after that I went looking for work doing film stuff. And I had lived in San Francisco for a while and worked with a filmmaker there. And then I moved to Texas. And that's where I saw a group of people doing things as an antique group, where they were just selling stuff that they found and bought. And I just, you know, it was the light bulb over the head moment, like, oh my gosh, you can sell all like these crazy things that I was seeing that people didn't seem interested where I came from. Mm-hmm. But here they're presented in a whole different way. And like, it seems like, oh, this is just raw material for people to make things and live creatively. And
was that, you know, in Texas? It was that way?
That was in Austin, Texas, yeah.
And what, they just used these things to recreate other things.
Yep, yep. Or we're using, I think culturally we were changing too at that time, mm-hmm. where people were way more acceptable to have found paintings in their homes and pictures that weren't necessarily from their family, but mm-hmm. they found interesting or exciting somehow. So
that's interesting, because a lot of times we'll have somebody come in, an artist come in with portraits, and they almost never sell.
Mm-hmm.
Because unless it's part of, in this area,
someone has a personal connection.
Unless there's a personal connection, it doesn't seem to be something that will move.
Mm-hmm.
But you found something different in Texas and other places.
Yeah.
Yes, that it didn't matter. It was something that appealed to them.
Right, yeah, but there was definitely an artist's eye to all of it that was different, that was not just other people's old stuff that was, you
they
know.
They created something from a number of different things.
They did all kinds of things with the context of these antiques and found things, and, mm-hmm. you know, there would be color fields of things, you know, or just really bizarre context of a painting of, like, an animal, and, you know, it just was weird and had energy that people liked, and they liked the recontextualization of these things.
Well, it makes it, even talking to you now, even makes, lends a lot more clarity to the show. And it is, it's interesting. It's a very eclectic group of things, but you do have some of your own work in it.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Yes. We have some slides. Maybe you can go through them and tell us. This is the gallery, obviously.
Right. Yeah, like there on the right, there's the theatrical backdrop.
Yes.
So that was probably used like in a local theater, or possibly even in a an Oddfellows Lodge type situation, where they would do kind of plays and things, and they would need backdrops. And, you know, it's probably from the 1930s. And I like the mystery of it being a portal, and then in the background, in the deep focus, you can see like another darker portal. So mm-hmm. it has some mystery of, you know, what's in there that I like. And the scale is really kind of fun too.
Yes, it is. Well, how about the, you know, the other, I had a number of people come in and comment on the anthracite ones
mm-hmm.
that you did. Did you do those?
No, those are things I found.
You found them,
mm-hmm.
and you didn't put them together. They were just found that way.
I found them that way, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's quite interesting.
I agree, yeah. And
that is.
That's classic folk art type thing.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Folk art. How about, it looks like a half of a mannequin there.
Right.
That's Tell us just, about that.
Yeah, that's something I found out, you know, in a field at a big outdoor antique show one year. I like it as like just a form.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a pleasing form, and it has that old faded linen that shows the age and mm-hmm. time, and I like that.
How old would you say that is?
Probably from the 30s, maybe even the 20s.
Yeah, it seems, because I looked at it and the linen, the fabric on it, it's very interesting. And the cigarette pack.
Yeah, that was
beveled glass.
Yeah, that was clearly from a door that was probably on a like a little candy store
right,
or corner shop or something. And on the backside of the of the decal of the cigarettes. It says, you know, like, goodbye, come again, kind of thing.
I didn't see that. So, I didn't look at the back of it. I did have to slide the glass behind.
I just like the simple imagery of it, and the kind of the precarious feel of it being on glass adds to the magic.
The magic of the pack of cigarettes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And then there's the nurse.
Yeah, the nurse. I mean, that just, it's so powerful. It's such a quiet image, but it also is very powerful. You know, it fills the frame, and it's this, you know, kind of classically 1940s Hollywood attractive woman shushing you as you come down the hallway.
Well, I had a man come in the other day who's interested in a number of your paintings. He's in the medical field.
Okay.
And I pointed that out to him, and he goes, well, he said, that looks like it's like from the 40s or the 50s. He said, I remember when I was first in medicine that he was stationed somewhere. He was in the Army or something. He was a medical person there. And he said there was this hospital, and there was a nurse there, and she was the nurse, but she ran the hospital. She was like the general. He said when she said something, you did it.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what that.
Yeah. She looks like
that's
she's serious.
That's exactly the
sure.
feeling you get when you look at that.
Yeah.
You really do.
Yeah.
Because somebody said, came in and said, I'm surprised the doctor's office didn't come in and get that. I said, not yet, but maybe soon.
Yeah.
Any other comments on? Oh, here we go.
Yeah, there was the president.
Yeah, Jimmy Carter.
Yeah, that's just, you know, I love that painting just because it's just unusual. There's two Jimmy Carters, and you know the teeth and just the expression, you know, and the person's like very obviously was very much trying very hard to capture something, and I think they did, but you know it's not as much when it comes to like the jacket and and whatnot. But you know, I like that. I like those kind of.
Where did you find that one? Do you remember?
I do remember that. I found at an antique fair, an outdoor antique fair in Madison, Bockville, New York.
Oh,
in
my.
Upstate New York.
Yeah, I know where. I'm familiar with upstate New York.
Yeah.
Yes, my husband's from that area. Yes, it's fascinating. Every time I go in to the gallery, I go over and look at that, and I don't know what it is.
There's something. It's strange, but kind of great.
Yes, if you want to see strange, please come see it.
Yeah. There's more strange.
You have another
than
one
that.
There, the father and the child.
Right. Yeah.
I don't know if that's.
I don't know
one
that we
that
have
the
photo of that. But,
no, but that yeah. that's an interesting one too.
Yeah, that's another one, and you know, it has that. I do love things that are clearly made with some passion and by a person that has a certain level of ability and talent, but not all of it, you know?
No.
So sometimes they can go sideways a little bit. And I think that painting that you're referring to is a classic example of that, because it seems like there was two levels of talent, one when they painted the man and one when they painted the baby, and then one when they painted the almost surrealist background of this open field where there's no signs of anything.
No, and it all kind of looks like there's not really any blended paint. It looks like it just came out of the tube and they put it on it. Or
like they
just
gave
me.
Up on subtlety.
Yeah, and they just thought, you know, we're not doing this. I'm just going to paint the rest of this. I'm tired of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's... They're interesting.
It has dreamlike qualities to it. Yeah.
Well, the reason I brought that up is because it's right next to Jimmy Carter.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, this painting's more interesting than that one, but it is.
Well, to me, they're all in the category of paintings that have passion and a little bit of mystery. Like, why? You know?
Like, why did you do this?
Why did you make this?
Mm-hmm.
But clearly, especially with that man and baby one, which we're not seeing right now, clearly someone had a very passionate reason that they were doing that.
Mm-hmm.
But we'll never know. So,
and they got tired. Probably
for the best that we don't know.
Is there none of these are signed, are they?
The Jimmy Carter one is signed. It's very faint, but it's signed at the bottom.
Okay.
On the front.
But the other one isn't.
I don't think there's a signature on that one at all that I can recall. No,
that always, for some reason, I think it's because it stands out from the other work.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's actual, it's like, you can say, this is a painting, and this is mm-hmm. whatever it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Whoever you want to be or whatever you want to be, I can look at that. Some of the other things are more eclectic.
Mm-hmm.
There's all kinds of things in there that make you think about the collages. Do you have any pictures? What's our next? Do we have another slide? Thanks. Okay, those are the cutouts.
Yeah, those are the famous silhouettes. Those
silhouette, right?
Yeah, those started, I don't know, 15 years ago, probably, maybe a little more than that, where I was working with. I always liked collage. As an art form, just because it's an immediate, like, cross-contextualize. You can mm-hmm. take this and put it here, and this and put it here, and there's a whole new thing mm-hmm. that may work or it may not. And I just like that technique of smashing stuff together that doesn't necessarily belong. Mm-hmm. So in my efforts to try to create something or figure out some new way I was going to do something, I was cutting out all kinds of things that I just found interesting, and I'd cut out a whole bunch of people from like 1940s snapshots that I had found, and they were doing rather banal stuff like standing there or, you know, kneeling or laying on a beach blanket. And I was going to try to fit them into these big photographs that I had of empty buildings and just see if I could make some kind of thing happen with that.
Mm-hmm.
And I started doing it, and it didn't work at all for me. And I think I went and did something, and I came back, and a bunch of the cutout photographs were laying upside down on the table.
Mm-hmm.
And that, like, instantly caught my eye. I was like, that looks interesting. And I started to just arrange them mm-hmm. on the table as they were, upside down. And
I
was like, that's kind of interesting. That has some energy. And I started cutting out more of those right away, and then I just would arrange fields of them and started making pieces just of silhouette fields.
I think there's two of them that were sold.
Yeah, people like them. People respond to them. I think people look at them, and I think a lot of times, consciously or unconsciously, you're thinking, am I in there? Is that me?
It could be.
So, yeah, I don't know. They are appealing to a lot of people.
And the latter.
And the latter, yeah, that's an object that I found many years ago, and I like the sense of danger.
Mm-hmm. It's
because
a
risk. It's a very narrow, tiny little ladder, and it was probably a barn painter's ladder based on the colors that are spilled all over it, but I like the patterns of spilled paint because they're unintentional, mm-hmm. and then that's all
a free thing.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And it's simple. It's not something to overthink. It's just a lovely object that's been affected by time and human presence.
And I haven't seen any of the kids try to climb it yet. It just occurred
that's
to
good.
Me, however.
Kids today have more sense, probably.
Maybe. You never know. And I think we have a couple more slides, don't we?
Okay.
Oh, yeah, there's your card.
Yep,
Mike
the
Miller,
card.
The exhibit card, and it has a, you can see more clearly the images that you have
mm-hmm.
on the silhouettes.
Yep. The six-armed man
yes.
piece is one of my favorite things. That was most likely a 1950s trade sign, like a handyman's trade mm-hmm. sign he probably put out in front of his shop, wherever he was doing business out of, and I like the, it has a Hindu deity kind of flavor to me, which clashes with exactly what you see. And I love that. I love that. Yeah.
Yes, it really does. When you think about it,
yeah.
I mean, I remember seeing it and thinking that, but
mm-hmm. yeah.
not quite putting it together
yeah.
the way you just did.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just thought, here's somebody who's really multitasking.
Yeah, he is super multitasking.
They need six hands.
Yeah.
Okay, and the next one? Oh, and that's, oh, these are the
okay, yeah,
24-hour news cycle, the one?
The series 24-hour news cycle, which, you know, I think that's, people can look at that and take their own conclusions from it. You know, I certainly had my ideas about what some of it meant, but, you know, it's best for people to look at that and think for themselves what mm-hmm. what it might be about. And this is, you know, that's something I probably found at an auction years ago. I've had that a long time. I just like the implied violence of it is really something to me, and the care in which a person put that together for their pistols. And I don't know, again, it goes back to very simple silhouette type imagery too for me, which mm-hmm. I'm attracted to. And that red color is kind of crazy.
And I think we, on that one, tell yeah. us about that one.
You know, that's just all just found stuff from the past few years. And
a COVID mask?
Yeah, there's the ubiquitous mask. And the pins, you know, the pins are something that I found mm-hmm. probably at the auction. And, you know, the title of that one is I Can't Even Hear Half of What You're Saying, because the one ear is missing from the medical dummy's head. And, yeah, that's a little bit about our current situation and what people want to know and what they refuse to know.
Yes, because they only want to think one way about it.
Yeah.
Don't confuse me with the facts.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's kind of, we're in that on both sides here.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like, and you wonder, And is that the last slide?
I'm not sure.
Or do we have another one? No, I think that was it.
Okay.
Your pictures, they came out. I mean, this is one of the most fascinating shows we've had.
That's very flattering.
Really.
Thank you.
Really. And every time I go in, I think of something, I see something different, which is good.
Yeah.
Very
definitely.
Good.
Yeah.
That you're always thinking.
I'm very happy
about
with how it turned out. I think it feels right, and it doesn't feel overjammed with things.
It's
just, you know, there's some ideas that you can just let play out and
people
yeah.
come away with their own thoughts.
Yeah.
About whatever it is they are fascinated with or not fascinated with.
Yeah.
But no, I found it quite interesting, and it really makes people think. And that was one of the, I mean, there were a lot of people there that night, Friday night.
Yeah, it was exciting. It
really
was fun.
Yes, it was very, very nice, and we thank you for sharing all that work with us.
You're welcome.
And now I'm going on just to remind everyone of a few things coming up at the Institute before our time is up. We've got like 3 minutes left.
Okay.
Okay. We have our mini session beginning November 13th. You can go on our website. There's a lot of 4 and 5 week classes that you can take if you're interested in trying anything. Good time to do it and find out if you really like something. The other thing is we have a concert coming up on November 11th. Our Jazz on the Avenue is back. We have one scheduled in November, December, February, and March. There may be more to come, but the first one will be November 11th at 7 o'clock in the Schumo Theater. And it's Ben Mauger's Vintage Band, and it's featuring, it's an evening of 20s music featuring Chris Heslop, Rhodes Whitehill, Bob Kreitz, and Doug Culp, along with Ben Maugers. So I hope to see you all there. You can get tickets online. And finally, we have the Elves and the Shoemaker opening on December 8th. It'll be with us the 8th, 9th, and 10th, a great way to kick off the season, Christmas holiday season with your children. This is a great interactive show, and it's so much fun for the kids, really, and the parents. Everybody enjoys it. So that will be on our website also. And I think that's about it. Anything else coming up for you, Mike, that you want to share?
No, nothing imminent. But I would like to take the chance to thank you again for having me, because it was really satisfying and really fun. And
you're more than welcome. We've totally enjoyed it. It adds another dimension to the arts. The arts shouldn't always be the same thing. You need to be discovering new ways of expression.
I agree.
And lastly, before I forget, Silent Sky, a play by Lauren Gunderson and directed by Andrea Kennedy Hart, opens tonight at the Schumo Theater at the Yocum Institute. I think pay what you will, whatever you will. And there's a show at 7:30 tonight, 7:30 Friday, 7:30 Saturday, and Sunday afternoon at 2. So be sure to stop by or come over and see it. You can get tickets online for that, I think. And it's just, or you can just come in and make a contribution. Thank you for joining us, and I hope you all have a really happy Thanksgiving. That'll be here before we know it. And we'll see you next month.
The Institute Presents on BCTV is supported by the Yocum Family Perpetual Charitable Trust.